Psalm 107 says, "They cried to the Lord in their trouble, and he saved them from their distress. He brought them out of the darkness and broke away their chains. Let them give thanks to the Lord for his unfailing love and his wonderful deeds for mankind, for he breaks down the gates of bronze and cuts through the bars of iron."
Been walking the same old road, miles and miles. And you've been hearing the same old voice, tell the same old lies. If you're trying to build the same old holes inside, well, there's a better life. There's a better life. If you got pain, he's a pain taker. Well, if you feel lost, he's a way maker. If you need freedom, saving, he's a prison shaking slinger. If you got chains, well, he's a chain breaker. We've all searched from the night of day and the dead of night. We've all found ourselves. Testify.
Turn to your neighbors and greet each other.
Boys and girls, if you'll come up, we'll have our time together. Boys and girls, come on up. We'll have our time together. Hey, Colin, come on up, man. Come on, James. Come on up. I don't think so. They are not too old. This is great. I got to get more. Hold on. It's perfect. It's what I was hoping for. Okay. Y'all are double dipping, right? You're double dipping. You were at the 9:30 as well. Praise the Lord. You wanted to hear the cool music at this service, didn't you? Any good? We have the best praise band. Yeah, well, look, it's time for school to start. Now, you, Colin, are blessed that you don't yet have to go to school. I don't mean to make it sound bad for the others that do. I'll just tell you a story about when I was in first grade. When I was in first grade, Miss Lewis said, "Boys and girls, tomorrow I have a treat for you." And so I thought that there was going to be ice cream, right? So the next day comes and said, "Boys and girls, I told you there was going to be a treat for you today. Who wants to learn to read?" All those stupid children put their hands up in the air. "I do, I do." I did not put my hand in the air. Miss Lewis said, "John, why didn't you put your hand in the air? Don't you want to learn to read?" I'm like, "No, ma'am, I don't." "Why don't you want to learn to read, John?" And I said, "Sounds like a lot of work to me." I was correct. Just by the way, it is a lot of work to learn to read, but it is wonderful, I have to admit. So you've got so much to look forward to when it's time for school and with school starting for you all. And you're going to be in the 9th grade, right? That's going to be so much fun. Okay, so I've got pens for you. You can put them on your backpack or whatever you want to do. So I'm going to pass these down. They're all the same. So you can just, yeah, get some of those. Yeah, get some of those. Absolutely. Hey, thank you, James. Yeah. All right, Miles. You got one, didn't you? It's your lucky day, you get two. You can give one to a friend. Okay, now, Pastor John always has candy as well. Would you like a piece of candy? Yes. Would you like a piece of candy? Yes. Piece of candy? Is there a red one in there? There it is. Candy? Yes. Yes. Yes, 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 yes. Did y'all get candy back there? Yes. Okay, good. Candy? I think the orange one looks good. I'm going to have an orange one. Okay, y'all. Thank you for coming up. Thank you. You're welcome, young man. My pleasure. So, Pia, before church was getting started, I saw this man up here, young man up here. I don't know. I figured he was, 18 or something. And I said, "Hi, my name's Pastor John." He's like, "Hi, my name's Isaac." It's like, this is Isaac Drummond, for those of you that are like, you know, Duck Church people. I haven't seen you maybe in a year, Isaac, except for just a fleeting moment in the grocery store a couple of weeks ago, but you are grown. Yeah, you are grown. Sing good, too. Yeah, amen. Yeah. Oh my, it's nice to see everybody. Glad that you're here. Some of you have been away on vacation because you live here, you go away for vacation. Some of you, it's your week to be here because you're here once a year. Some of you are here from Manio. We're just so glad that everybody's here. Welcome, welcome, welcome. I want to tell you about a couple of things. The sermon today is going to be about grief. There are all different kinds of grief, aren't there? There's the kind of grief that we experience when somebody dies. There's the kind of grief that we experience when something happens to our lives and it turns upside down. Like, I don't know, when raccoons come and just, you know, live in your house. Raccoons came and lived in someone's house this summer, and that was really bad. Raccoons also came and lived in our church about 4 years ago. Does anybody remember that? It cost us $150,000. That was grief, okay? So, no, they're all different kinds of grief, and that's what I want to talk about today. And I also want to mention to you there's going to be a grief share group. Grief share is a really cool thing. It is a small group environment where people can share about their personal and unique journey of grief. It goes with videotapes and video clips. It's really an excellent group. We'll be starting here at the church. Let me get the date for you. We'll be starting here at the church very soon. Yeah, Tuesday, September the 4th, 1 o'clock here at the church. I've never been in grief share. I've never led a grief share group, and I've never been in one as a participant, but I've had relatives that were, and it's just amazingly helpful to people. It's good to be in a group with other people that are going through something similar to what you are. I don't think anybody's grief is the same, but to be in a group with people that are going through something similar is a blessing. So if you'd like to be a part of that, then just call the church office, let us know. We've been having these groups since 2007. Lynn Blackburn leads them. She's a great counselor. It's really good. On Wednesday nights, we're out in the chapel at 7 o'clock for prayers for healing and miracles. So if you need a miracle or you know somebody that does, come. Be with us in the chapel. If you can just come week after week and just be bathed in those healing prayers, that's a wonderful thing. Now, let's see. It's time for a really great mission video. Do you think? Yep. Got sound? Excellent. This is one of the best mission videos I've like ever seen. I love this mission video because our church is in ministry with Kitty Hawk Elementary. It's just cool. So watch this.
Good morning, Duck Church. This is Lisa Walker. And I'm here today to talk about the tutoring program that we have at Kitty Hawk Elementary School. Last year we had 4 kindergarten classes, and this year it's been downsized to 3. But one of them is a special class. It's going to be a Spanish immersion class. The goal is that by the time these children finish first grade, they will be fluent in Spanish and therefore be bilingual, which will help in their education. If you have a desire to help the kids and you can speak a little bit of Spanish, maybe on the kindergarten, first grade level, I would love for you to reach out and give me a call because I would love to have 2 volunteers in the classroom. I want to share my personal story of last year at graduation. When I got there to help, I was told that they had reserved a seat for me to actually watch the graduation. I got a special invitation, and the teacher had to point out that I was sitting in the front row. So that was absolutely amazing. When I got there that morning, one of the little ones was a little upset, and I went over to her and I said, "Well, why are you upset?" And she said, "Well, I have to speak in front of everybody on the stage, and I'm really, really nervous, and my tummy hurts." And I said, "Well, I want you to do something for me. Look out for your mom." And she said, "Well, my mom's going to be on the stage because she's one of the teachers." I said, "Well, then look out for me. And just look at me when you do it." And here I was in the front row, and I saw when she was getting ready to speak, and those little eyes cut into my direction, and she smiled, and I gave her the thumbs up. And she did beautiful, and I winked at her when it was over, and she was just beaming. So I felt really good about that. So I'm telling you, if you've got an hour and you want to share your knowledge and your love for children, please contact me and I will see what I can do to get you in there and have the same experience. Thank you.
If the ushers will come forward, we'll receive the morning tithes and offerings. Welcome the Dare Challenge men today. So glad y'all are here. Yeah. It blesses us when you're here with us. Thank you for being here. The scripture today is a very short one. It comes from Matthew chapter 5, verse 4. Jesus said, "Blessed are those who mourn. They will be comforted." Christian mourning is a very strange thing. There are some strange ideas about Christian mourning out there. Somehow or other, some people have the idea that Christians are not supposed to really mourn, that Christians are supposed to rejoice all the time. You know, and I know that Philippians just does say, "Rejoice in the Lord always," and again I say rejoice, but it doesn't mean that Christians don't don't mourn. The Bible says that we don't mourn as those do who have no hope. Christians don't mourn in the same way that people who have no hope mourn. And that is different. Let's just think for a moment about occasions that cause us to mourn. An obvious occasion is when someone we love dies. And that certainly causes us to mourn. There are other things that happen in life that cause us to mourn too, maybe in a different way. But sometimes when you love someone and they stop loving you, that can be like a death. Sometimes when you lose a person, not by death, maybe not by relationship, but they just move out of your life in some way, that just brings mourning to us. Sometimes when we have financial setbacks, we were doing fine financially, and then all of a sudden we lose everything. That's a kind of mourning because it's an enormous loss for us. So the mourning that I'm addressing today is partly the mourning of when someone dies, but it's also other kinds of mourning too. And mourning is a very personal thing. Something may cause you to mourn that others would say, well, you shouldn't be so upset about that. Well, who are they to say what you ought to be upset over, right? We mourn the way we mourn. And what causes us to mourn is deeply personal. So I just want to mention that to you when we're thinking about mourning. We're thinking about mourning in a lot of different ways. When we say that the scripture says that Christians don't mourn as those who have no hope do, that's really important. Now, those who have no hope, they don't know God, and so when things tank in their lives, they don't have God to turn to. For us, when things tank in our lives, we have God to turn to. And so we don't mourn as those who have no hope. One example of that for me is that when somebody dies. When somebody dies, if you know the Lord and if you have faith in what Jesus tells us about heaven, you're not mourning for them. They're good. I'm going to tell you something. I was 12 years old. I was a Boy Scout. I was on one of my first camping trips. And the Scoutmaster's got us, you know, around the campfire. And for some reason or other, he thought it'd be a great idea to talk about death and dying. I don't know why. T. Ben Douglas, he was the Scoutmaster, member of my daddy's church. He was a great guy. He was a great Scoutmaster. But anyway, so they start talking about death and dying. Well, and, you know, I pop up and say, oh, I'm looking forward to that. And T. Ben Douglas says, what? I said, dying. I can't wait. That's going to be so great. I cannot wait to get to heaven. And he's like, you don't mean that, right? I'm like, no, I'm serious. I cannot wait to get to heaven. So he thinks I'm suicidal, right? Now, this bothers the Scoutmaster, you know. He thinks he's got a 12-year-old tenderfoot Boy Scout on a camping trip who's suicidal, right? So he was really concerned. I mean, I could see my dad's a preacher, right? We're supposed to think going to heaven is good. To us, that's normal. Somebody said to me last week, they said, repeat after me, I'm not normal, okay? But anyway, for us, the way I was raised, for us, you know, to live as Christ and to die as gain. And so even when I was 12, I was kind of like, yeah, I am looking forward to going to heaven. And he said, well, isn't there any reason that you want to live? I'm like, no, not particularly. I mean, I don't mind living, but I'm really looking forward to going to heaven. This bothered me even more. And he's like, don't you want to do anything before you die? I'm like, well, I mean, there's stuff to do. like, I'd like to become first class Boy Scout. He's like, then you don't want to die. I'm like, okay. You know, it's like, okay. You know, I could see this bothering him. Like, yeah, easing on out of this. But, you know, for Christians, if you have that kind of faith, not everybody does, and it's okay. You know, God can handle it if your faith isn't that strong already. God's not threatened by us having weak faith. But if you have a strong kind of faith, when somebody dies, and I don't care how old or how young they are, heaven's better than here. And when somebody dies, we're not sorry for them. We're happy for them. I'm going to tell you, you've heard me say it before. I'll say it again. One reason is because it gives me a lot of pleasure. The best day of my life, whether it's this afternoon or whether it's I'm 110, the best day of my life is going to be when the Lord Jesus comes to me and says, got everything ready. Everything's ready. Come on. Let's go. That's going to be the best day of my life. I can't wait. Can you imagine how much fun it's going to be to explore heaven? A whole new way of living? Seeing Jesus face to face, being in fellowship with loved ones that we haven't seen for a long time, enjoying a place that God says, I've prepared this for you, and he is good at making things good. Like, you like this place, right? You like the Currituck Sound, right? You like the beach, right? God made that. He's really good at making things that deeply thrill us. I want to be in. That's going to be good. Meanwhile, you and I have a responsibility to live lovingly and faithfully, and that's good too. Can I get an amen? But when people die, if we have faith, we're not mourning because they've gone to a better place. We're mourning because we have sustained an irreparable loss. And it is for us an irreparable loss. If I got in an accident and my arm were cut off, the stump would heal, but I wouldn't be growing a new arm. It would be an irreparable loss. It would heal, but it would be an irreparable loss. I'd get a prosthetic. I'd learn to live with a prosthetic. But I would never have that arm again, and it would be an irreparable loss. I think grief is that way a lot of times. In some sense, we heal from grief. In some sense, it heals. But in another sense, it's an irreparable loss that will never be replaced. And we're not trying to pretend that that's not true. And yet, somehow, mysteriously, life continues to well up within us, even when we don't want it to, even when we don't want to cooperate it, even when we're so depressed and so low, we may feel like we're done with living. Somehow, the life of God just keeps welling up within us, and the life of God within us kind of buoys us on, even when we don't have the strength to buoy ourselves on, because we're just paralyzed with grief. Sometimes that happens to us. We don't mourn like those who have no faith because we know that God has a place for us that we're going to, so that's good. Also, we don't mourn like those who have no faith when we sustain a personal loss that's different from death because we know that we can trust God to provide for us what we need. God has not died. God has not suffered. God is still whole. And God is still able to provide you and me with what we need for a productive life. And so in that sense, we don't mourn as those who don't know God because we know the source of everything. And we know that he loves us and wants to provide for us as a loving father provides for his children. And so in that sense, we don't mourn like those who don't know God because we do know the master of the universe. And he knows us. He knows our name. He knows what we need. And he says, my eye's on the sparrow. And don't be afraid, because you're worth a lot more than sparrows. However, even though we don't mourn like those who don't know God, we mourn. The Bible doesn't say Christians don't mourn. It says they don't mourn in the same way as those who have no hope. We have hope in God, but we mourn. There's a funny little scripture. I say it's funny. It's funny the way it gets interpreted. I'm gonna share it with you. It's from 2 Corinthians, but I got to check my notes. I think I've got the, yep. It's 2 Corinthians chapter 6, verse 10, where it says, we're joyful in our sorrows. We're joyful in our sorrows. 2 Corinthians 6:10. Sometimes Christians get that mixed up with their grieving theology, which is a mistake. I'm not saying if you're grieving and you're joyful that that's a problem. If you're grieving and you're joyful, I'm glad for you. But what I want to say is, you don't have to do it that way. The Bible is not telling you that you need to be joyful in your grieving. Because this passage is not talking about death, and it's not talking about grieving. It's talking about persecution. What Paul is talking about in this passage is that he has been persecuted in a lot of different ways. You remember Paul was beaten with rods. That's worse than it sounds. He was whipped repeatedly. That is as bad as it sounds. He was arrested. He was imprisoned. I've got a feeling their prisons were even worse than ours. He was shipwrecked, and he was eventually martyred. And so in this passage, he's saying, I've suffered all these things, and that is a real kind of suffering, and yet I'm also joyful because of the work that I'm doing in Christ. That's the context of the scripture. It's not about losing someone in death and being sorrowful and joyful at the same time. Sorrowful yet rejoicing. And yet, somehow, that scripture is misused about mourning and about death. I even saw it on a sympathy card recently. A Christian sympathy card. Which is okay, but it's just out of context. But this kind of idea kind of makes Christians feel guilty about grieving, which is very strange. The Bible does not teach us that we shouldn't grieve. In fact, we should grieve, and we should grieve well. Do you remember that in the Bible, there's a whole book called Lamentations? There's a whole book of the Bible called Lamentations. Now, it's not as thick as Isaiah. It's a relatively thin book. But the book of Lamentations is about the nation of Israel mourning the loss of their nation, because their nation was defeated by the Babylonians in 586 BC. And so this book of Lamentations is a book of mourning their national loss and trying to figure out what went wrong. So I just want to say to you that if there's a whole book about mourning, about lamenting in the Bible, it's okay for you to mourn and lament when you suffer a loss. It's not just okay, it's appropriate. In fact, what I would think is that it would be inappropriate for you to sustain a great loss and pretend you didn't. That would be odd. Now, if you want to pretend you didn't and that helps you, then I'm supporting you in that, right? I'm just saying you don't need to pretend you didn't sustain a loss when you did. That's not something Scripture or God asks of you. Instead, we mourn and we're blessed in it. Jesus said, blessed are those who mourn. They shall be comforted. So when you're going through a loss and a hard time, it's appropriate to mourn. Now, I mentioned to you a moment ago that the nation of Israel was trying to figure out the reasons for their loss in the book of Lamentations. Sometimes we do that too, and sometimes that's helpful, and sometimes it's not. When something awful happens to you, when a tragedy happens to you, sometimes we can't resist trying to figure out why. Why? We look back over our actions and say, what did I do that contributed to this disaster? And we say, I'm never doing that again. That's good. In the case of a death, that's different. Why do people die? Well, people die because they're people. They're human. Our bodies wear out, some sooner than others. We get sick and we die. That's a part of being human. We don't need to ask God, like this is some mystery of the universe, why did my loved one die when they got sick? It's part of being human. We live for a while, and then we go to be with the Lord. And for some of us, we live a very long time. And for others, it seems much too short. But it shouldn't be genuinely mysterious to us or seem like some sort of special event from God, when the truth is God made us mortal. Our bodies are mortal. We get sick or get in accidents and die. But sometimes we can't help trying to figure it out. We just can't help it. Sometimes we can't help looking up to God and saying, why did you let this happen? Why did you let this happen? Why? Just tell me why. I think that's probably completely useless. It might be that God will answer your question, you know? But for the most part, I think that's probably not helpful. To say, why? If God wants you to know why, he'll show that to you at the right time and in the right way. But sometimes, if you get stuck pointing your finger at God saying, why did you do this to me? That's not very helpful. Because the only one that can really help you when the bottom drops out of your world is God. And if you pick a fight with him at that particular moment in your life, you're in a world of trouble. Because he's the one that can help you. And if you are determined to pick a fight with the only one that can help you, that is cutting off your nose to spite your face. But some people do that. And if you can't resist, go ahead. But I just want to counsel you, if you can stop short of that, that would be wise, and that would be well. When disaster befalls us, it's a really wise thing if you can run to Jesus. When disaster befalls us, if you can just run to Jesus and say, I don't understand, I don't really need to understand, but I need you. Oh, I need you. I need you. Oh, I need you. Every hour I need you. Oh, bless me now, my Savior. I come to you. Anybody here raised on a farm or familiar with chickens? Yeah, some of you are familiar with chickens. Yeah, I wasn't raised on a farm, but I spent some time in a rural area when I was growing up in Rosewood, North Carolina, and my uncle had a farm as well, did my share of cropping tobacco when I was a teenager. Crop tobacco in the morning, wait on tables at a French restaurant at night. You tell me how I got the tobacco gums off my hands to wait on tables at a French restaurant at night. But you know how it works with chickens. You remember when there's a storm coming up, the mother hen will stretch her wings really big, right? and the little bitties will run to her. They'll get just as close to her as they can. And then she'll bring those wings around them and settle in. They are so snug, and they feel so safe while that storm is going on. You and I are God's little bitties. When trouble comes, when the storms come, he stretches his wings wide to you and says, come on, snuggle up close. And we run to him. And as we do, Psalm 91 says, he covers us with his wings. That's a good place to be. Now, have you ever seen somebody coming up and you didn't know if they were going to try to hug you or not, right? And you didn't want to kind of, you know, do the hug if they were not going to do the hug, so you don't want to get caught there. But also, some folks are coming up to you, and you can see it in their eyes that they are going to hug you, and you do not want that. Gentlemen, what do you do? That's what you do, isn't it? Yep. You take a little step forward, and you put your arm out like this, and if you really don't want a hug, you straighten your elbow so it's stiff. It's called the stiff arm, isn't it, fellas? It's called the stiff arm. Nobody can hug you when you're shaking hands like this, right? Well, some of us stiff arm God. Well, that's the thing. It's like we want a relationship with God, but we want to add a little bit of a distance, if you please. We do want a relationship with God, but we want that stiff arm relationship with God because we don't want God meddling our business too much. We want to take care of our own business, and God, if I've got a problem, I will be sure to let you know, right? That's the kind of relationship some people have with God. Well, if you've got a stiff arm relationship with God, which is way better than no relationship with God, if you've got a stiff arm relationship with God, when grief comes to your door, it's going to be more difficult for you to have intimacy with God because you don't already have an intimate relationship with God. So, when grief comes to your door, what you want to do is you want to run to Jesus and be as intimate and close to him as you can get, right? But if you don't already have an intimate relationship with Jesus Christ before trouble comes to you, it's going to be harder to manage. So I just want to suggest to you, if you want to be able to weather life's storms better instead of worse, if you can develop intimacy with God while things are going okay, then when the bottom drops out, you have an intimate relationship with God to draw upon. Next thing I want to say about grief is, and this is the last thing I'm going to say, everybody's grief is different. And that's okay. When you're grieving, I imagine it's a little bit like getting caught in a riptide. I don't think I've ever been caught in a riptide. You would think I would know it if I had. I don't think I've ever been caught in a riptide, but I've read about it. And sometimes you just sort of wander into a riptide. You don't see it. Now, Outer Bankers can see it. They know to avoid it. But people that are not from around here, they can't see it, and they wander into it. And when it gets you, you're probably not swimming out of it. When the riptide gets you, the best thing you can do is just kind of relax a little bit and go with it. And then once it weakens, then you might be able to swim parallel to the shore and then come in once you're out of the riptide. Grief is a little bit that way. Grief, in a really strong way, it'll come and get you. And you're no longer in control of your emotions or anything else for those moments that grief has got you in the riptide. My suggestion is just relax and go with it. When the grief comes on you and you start crying or you get sad, be sad, cry, it's okay. And then when that riptide lets you go and you feel good again and you want to laugh, laugh. When you're able to enjoy and celebrate life even in the midst of your grief, do it and don't feel guilty about it. When you can't enjoy and celebrate life because you're grieving, grieve and don't feel guilty about it. Everybody's grief is different, and you don't have to match your grief to somebody else's. Finally, be patient with those that are trying to comfort you. They say really stupid things. Can I get an amen? They say really stupid things, and they're just trying to help. So forgive them. In the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. Praise team.
Praise unending, 10,000 years have been forever.
receive this benediction, and now unto him who is able to keep you from falling and to present you faultless before the throne of grace with exceeding joy. Unto the only wise God be honor, glory, dominion, and power, and may the love of God Almighty, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit be upon you and remain with you now and forever. Amen.
Bless the Lord, Almighty.